Croes o pawb. My name is Evan. I'm the current chair of the Welsh Junior Doctors Committee, and I have just completed my GP training in Bridgend. Welcome everyone to this contract reform explainer event, and many thanks for taking your precious time out today out of your busy clinical schedules to learn more about the contract reform package that the BMA has negotiated for you. In this event, we will cover the background behind the contract deal, the detail of the proposed new contract, some information about how you could expect it to be implemented, and a discussion of the respective advantages and disadvantages of deal, information about the referendum and next steps, and then an opportunity for you to ask any questions you might have. Before we go into detail about the proposed new contract, I'll briefly explain how we got to this point. As you may be aware, in 2019, the UK Junior Doctors Committee renegotiated the English Junior Doctor contract, which is commonly called the 2016 contract. And this was approved by a referendum of members. Following this, the Welsh Government invited the BMA Welsh Junior Doctors Committee to join them and NHS Wales employers in talks in social partnership to explore the possibility of contract reform in Wales and examine the newly negotiated 2016 contract and what its potential implications could be in Wales. After consideration, WJDC decided to enter these talks and began consulting members on what its priorities should be for contract reform. In January 2020, we toured workplaces in Wales, talking to junior doctors about what their issues with their working lives were and what could be done about them. We also issued a survey of all junior doctors in Wales. Time and again, the same issues were coming up. Junior doctors were tired, were working unsustainable shift patterns and felt like they had little control over their rotas and working lives. They felt taken advantage of and unrecognized. With rota monitoring often unsuccessful, they felt health boards had little accountability for when they were overworked or missed training. WJDC took this feedback on board and created its priorities for the possible renegotiation that would come out of the contract reform discussions. We assembled very swiftly a team of negotiators from amongst the committee who were trained by expert BMA staff and supported by a robust decision-making structure. The talks then began shortly before the COVID-19 pandemic in March 2020. Talks were understandably paused until later in the year and again at the height of the second wave of infections. The talks consisted of three phases. The first was a fact-finding process where we established a shared understanding of the problems we wish to solve with Welsh Government and NHS Wales employers, reviewed the current landscape, and heard from employers and junior doctors in England about the positives and negatives of their contract, as well as the pitfalls of implementation. This process has led us to conclude collectively that contract reform was desirable and there was sufficient alignment on what would be desirable to proceed. The second phase was a line-by-line review of the 2016 contract in England. During this process, we were able to put forward a range of reforms that we argued would improve the contract or make it more suitable to Wales if it were to be implemented here. You'll hear more about this in a minute. Finally, we concluded the reform process by negotiating on areas where a mutual agreement couldn't otherwise be reached. What has resulted from this is a contract reform package agreed by ourselves, Welsh Government and the NHS Wales employers, funded by Welsh Government investment that we believe addresses a range of long-standing issues in Wales and represents a real step forwards for junior doctors. So, to begin, we'll give a brief overview of the proposed contract package. After this, we'll go through the details of the contract. Underpinning all the changes is an additional investment by Welsh Government to the value of 3% of the current junior doctor workforce cost. This additional money would not have been invested outside of contract reform as allowed for the wide-ranging rota safeguards and the transitional protections that you hear about shortly. The proposed new contract is based upon the 2016 contract in England, with comprehensive rota limits, exception reporting, and work scheduling. We decided this was the best starting point for the reforms we knew were needed in Wales. Welsh Government saw contractual alignment with England as a priority, but we insisted on the ability to negotiate changes to the contract to improve upon it and make it better suited to Wales. Pay under the proposed contract is based on a 5-point nodal pay system that increases the amount of pay contained within basic pay, which enhances pension contributions. There are additional payments for a range of additional working patterns. The contract would introduce comprehensive safeguards to limit fatiguing rotas that have not yet been seen in Wales. These safeguards will be explained in more detail later. Exception reporting would be introduced. This is a system for reporting additional hours work and missed training. Individual work schedules will define your role, hours of work and training opportunities, and ensure that clinical and training responsibilities are properly balanced. Minimum notice periods for providing rotas before starting placements will be contractualised. Multiple areas of the NHS Wales Fatigue and Facilities Charter have been contractualised, providing assurances regarding the provision of parking and rest as well as mess facilities. Two new roles will be introduced to help build the culture needed around the contract and enforce its systems: the guardian of safe working and the champion of flexible training. There will be no multi-year pay deal as part of this contract reform. Implementation will take place from August 2023 to August 2024, and we have negotiated a cash flow pay protection for all continuing trainees in Wales.
We'll now move on to discuss the pay system in more detail. The proposed contract is based upon a 5-point nodal pay structure. Each pay point is awarded upon attaining a specific training grade, detailed in the chart on the right. The basic pay is the value of a nominal 40-hour week conducted in plain time. All other elements of pay are derived from this figure. Here you can see how this is set out against all training grades. As you can see, in some years, substantial pay rises are seen. These are tied to years where clinical duties typically expand or where additional responsibilities are taken on. We negotiated higher basic pay levels than currently seen in England and successfully argued for a basic pay scale which reflects the annual pay uplifts that junior doctors have experienced in Wales over the last 3 years, rather than the 2% a year multi-year pay deal that was agreed in England in 2019. Overall, this means that basic pay under the proposed contract would be 4.8% higher than in England, which will of course increase the value of all other pay elements. Whilst this has allowed us to avoid some of the pay erosion seen in England, we're absolutely clear that this is not good enough. As a union, we are committed to pay restoration to 2008 levels, and we'll talk later on about how that aim is compatible with this contract reform. The proposed contract places a greater emphasis on basic pay and less on premium time pay than the current contract, whilst in most instances maintaining an overall neutral effect on pay for individual rotas. This means that pay is more consistent across rotations between high intensity and low intensity rotas than the current banding system. By increasing basic pay across all grades, it also enhances the value of the NHS pension. As you can see on this chart, basic pay is higher across all training grades on the proposed contract than on the old contract. Under the current contract, your banding supplement pays for any hours above 40 that you work, your night work and your weekend work. In the proposed contract, these are all split out into separate payments, which recognise more exactly the precise work you are performing, rather than the broad brush that banding provides. Any additional hours that you work above 40 hours, up to the 48-hour weekly maximum, will effectively be paid at an hourly rate of 1/40th of your basic pay. Hours that are worked at night, defined as 9 p.m. to 7 a.m, are paid at an enhanced hourly rate of 37%. Shifts that begin between 8 p.m. and midnight will attract enhanced rates on all hours up until 10 a.m. the next day. Shifts ending between midnight and 4 a.m. will be paid at the enhanced rate throughout. You will note that there is a change here compared to the current contract in terms of premium hours. Under the current contract, any work after 7 p.m, not 9 p.m, is counted towards the banding supplement. This change in premium hours was a difficult area of negotiation, where we made clear that it is hard to reasonably see 9 p.m. as a normal working time. However, this was a red line for employers, and it's the same as the contract in England. In exchange for ensuring that Friday night shifts that extend into a Saturday were counted towards weekend allowances, the committee ultimately decided that it could accept this change. With the overall increase in basic pay, in many instances, this is a cost-neutral change for pay purposes, and safe working limits will ensure that hours you do work are not overly antisocial or unsafe. As just mentioned, any work conducted on weekends count towards the weekend frequency allowance, as well as the hours of work performed on the weekend paid at either the additional hour rate or enhanced rate. The weekend frequency allowance, set at the rates on the right, is paid as a percentage of basic pay depending on the frequency of weekend work on the rota. Any shift that takes place partially or wholly on a Saturday or Sunday will contribute to the weekend frequency calculation, although for NROC duty periods, only those commencing on a Saturday or Sunday will count. This is an improvement upon the contract in England, where shifts starting on a Friday and continue into the weekend don't count towards the weekend frequency for pay purposes. Here is a quick illustrative example of how the core elements of the pay system work. The numbers here are arbitrary and do not represent an actual rota. The trainee is an ST1, so paid at nodal point 3, and works a 48-hour average work week with 12 hours outside of plane time per week average across the rota and one in four weekends. They are paid £42,180 for their 40-hour basic week. Because they work an average of 48 hours, they are then paid for 8 additional hours at 1/40th of the basic pay, coming to an annualised total of £8,436. They work 12 of their 48 hours in the enhanced hours, which are 9 p.m. to 7 a.m. Therefore, they are paid 12 times 0.37 as an additional rate for these hours, totalling £4,682. Finally, they are paid a weekend frequency allowance for one in four weekends of £3,164. This comes to a total of £58,462. To this, you can then add non-residential on-call allowance if they do NROC work and any pay premia or allowances they may be eligible for. Hopefully, this illustration demonstrates how the new pay system splits up what would normally be a simple banding calculation into multiple pay elements, all of which must be accounted for. Incidentally, for comparison, the same rota under the old contract would be a 1A banding. Applied to the starting point of the registrar scale, this would come to £53,112, some £5,000 lower. Non-residential on-call work would be paid via two components. There would be an allowance of 8% of basic pay to recognise the general inconvenience of making yourself available for on-call work. Further to this, you would be paid for the actual hours of work asked of you when non-residential on-call according to the hour rates described earlier. These are estimated at the start of the placement and paid monthly, with any hours above the estimate reported and paid in addition. The final element of pay to be introduced in the proposed contract is the pay premia. These are pay supplements to either incentivise certain training pathways or recognise specific experience that you will be contributing to the NHS. Two improvements were achieved here on the contract in England. All pay premia will be paid as a percentage of a fixed nodal point, i.e. not the nodal point that you are currently being paid at. This ensures that the pay premia increase in value in line with the value of basic pay, as this is uplifted by the annual pay award, keeping better pace with inflation than if they were fixed cash values, as in England. We also negotiated a new type of pay premium. We will discuss this now before describing the other pay premia that have been agreed. The new pay premium will be called the Flexible Training Pay Premium. This premium is designed to recognise the experience that trainees gain during clinical fellowships or F3 years following completion of their foundation training before they begin core or speciality training. Where a trainee has undertaken this experience, be it in the Welsh NHS, another NHS, or outside the UK, they will then receive a pay premium of 12.5% of nodal point 3 upon return to training. For those who took 1 year out, they will be paid this for 1 year only at ST or CT2 level. For those who took 2 years out, they will receive it at ST or CT1 and 2 level. The premium ends upon entering ST3, when you will progress to a nodal point 4 anyway. The premium will also be payable to trainees who change speciality and as a result drop below nodal point 4. They will be paid it until they have progressed through training again to an ST3 level, at which point they will again be paid at the nodal point 4. You will have to have had 2 years in your current programme and be otherwise adequately progressing in your training in order to receive the premium. If you have to change speciality due to disability or caring needs, your pay will be fully pay protected upon transfer to the new training programme rather than receiving this premium. In both scenarios, we also managed to negotiate the provision that parental leave periods will count towards qualifying years for the premium, ensuring people who take this leave aren't disadvantaged here. This is a significant new element to the contract for Wales. We negotiated this premium specifically to compensate for some of the loss of automatic pay progression in the new contract, which we know can particularly impact speciality and core trainees. This provision ensures that where you have taken time out and still continue to build your medical skills, this will be recognised when you return to training. Here you can see the range of pay premia that would be included in the new contract. A GP pay premium will be introduced, payable when in GP practice placements. This replaces the 45% banding for GP trainees in the current contract. It will be paid at 18% of nodal point 4, which is currently around £9,500. Workforce priority area premia will be designed in partnership with the Welsh Government and NHS Wales employers. These replace the hard-to-fill speciality premium in the English contract and will be paid to trainees taking up specific posts identified as workforce planning priorities. This may cover a specific speciality or a specific geography, for example. This premium will be funded outside of contract reform and the areas will be agreed between ourselves, government, employers and HEIW and will be reactive to the needs of the NHS in Wales. It will be our intention to establish the fuller details on which areas will initially be focused upon during the implementation phase. Clinical academics will receive a pay premium to the value of 9% of nodal point 4. This is payable to trainees on integrated clinical academic pathway at the point that they return to their training programme after completing their qualification. For trainees not on an integrated pathway, it will again be payable after completion of the qualification, including if the qualification was obtained prior to commencing their training, as long as it is deemed relevant by the HEIW postgraduate dean. Oral and maxillofacial surgery trainees will receive a pay premium to recognise their double study in medicine and dentistry. It will be paid at 9% of nodal point 4, which is just under £5,000. Finally, an exceptional pay premium will exist, which may be utilised to recognise extraordinary contributions, for example, to public health emergencies. Less than full-time trainees face fixed annual costs regardless of their percentage training rate. They face these costs for more years than full-time trainees as it takes them more years to complete training. In order to recognise this, a less than full-time allowance will be introduced. Like the pay premia, this allowance is paid as a percentage of a fixed nodal point at a current value of just over £1,000. We have ensured that the new training-based pay system doesn't unfairly impact trainees taking parental leave. Therefore, during periods of parental leave, if you would have otherwise reasonably expected to progress to a new training grade with a new nodal point, You'll be paid from that point onwards as though you had progressed, even during your leave. If you are transferring to a new training programme, for example, from core to speciality training, you will receive the increased pay retrospectively upon your return to training.
Shumai, my name is Daniel, another one of the negotiators. With the core elements of the pay system now explained, we will progress to discussing the working hours provisions of the proposed contract. One of the most important areas of reform achieved in this contract package are the new limits to working hours. The 2002 contract allows exhausting and frankly unsafe working conditions to take place, many of which you'll know well. These include the 12-day stretches of shifts, long strings of nights, and inadequate rest between night and day shifts. These extreme working patterns have been highly antisocial. They do not allow a good work-life balance, and they have led to increased burnout, delayed training, and less safe working. The committee was clear to its negotiators that these dangerous shift patterns had to end. It's a pleasure, therefore, to say that the comprehensive limits you see in front of you now were able to be agreed, in addition to statutory working time regulations. This is a key area of contract reform. With this change, if the contract is accepted, Welsh junior doctors will take a significant step towards safer working, underpinned by employer obligations that carry financial penalties if breached. Break provisions are clearer too, with 30 minutes provided for 5-hour shifts, two 30-minute breaks for 9-hour shifts, and a third break for shifts longer than 12 hours. These breaks can be timed flexibly and can be combined, and if they are missed, they can be exception reported. There are also new safety limits for non-residential on-call work, when you are at home but may be expected to provide telephone advice or attend your workplace if needed. On the new contract, these duty periods cannot last longer than 24 hours, cannot be worked consecutively except at weekends, and may not be rostered at a greater frequency than 3 every 7 days. Where on-call work is considered low intensity, less than 3 hours of actual work during the duty period, there will be a limit of 7 consecutive duties in line with the total limit on 7 consecutive duties worked in the contract. A maximum of 12 duties will be allowed by local agreement with appropriate checks and balances. During on-call duty periods, you will now be entitled to a minimum of 8 hours rest, 5 of which must be continuous, and the following day you cannot be rostered for more than 10 hours work, or 5 if your rest entitlements weren't met. Where your rest was impeded by service demands during your on-call duty period, your employer must now make immediate arrangements for compensatory rest. The default assumption will be that you are too tired to work and other arrangements must be found to cover your next shift at no financial cost to you. Another important safety entitlement in the proposed new contract is that all trainees who are undertaking out-of-hours work and then decide, based on their own judgment, that they are too tired to drive home after the shift has ended, will now be provided with a rest facility by their employer. If this isn't possible, the cost of a safe journey home by other means must be covered by the employer. If you need to pick your car up the next day, this may be covered too. Too often, trainees in Wales told us about being scared to drive home after exhausting shifts because they were so fatigued. And we all know the tragic stories about trainees who sadly are injured or worse when they lose concentration or fall asleep whilst driving home. This contractual, enforceable new right is a significant advancement in terms of trainee welfare and safety in this area. Annual leave entitlements remain unchanged at 5 weeks and 3 days, rising to 6 weeks and 3 days after 5 years of service. This includes the additional day of leave that was granted last December by the Minister, as well as previous statutory days. Fixed leave will now no longer be allowed, nor will rotas be allowed to be designed in such a way as to make the flexible taking of leave difficult. Another significant change is the contractual definition of a day of leave. We heard from trainees that there was inconsistency across Wales with regards to the application of annual leave, with some trainees having to take more than one day of leave if the shift that day was longer than 8 hours. From now on, no matter how long the shift is, as long as it doesn't attract enhanced rates of hourly pay, it will be worth one day of leave. Other shifts must be swapped, as is currently the case, although employers must facilitate this. Furthermore, shared parental leave would be introduced for trainees in Wales, and leave for significant life events, such as family weddings, cannot now be unreasonably refused as long as sufficient notice is given. What underpins these safety limits is the work schedule. Instead of currently, where just the duty roster is provided to you with your slot, under the proposed new contract, instead, you will agree a personalised work schedule with your educational supervisor. This would detail your clinical commitments, your other professional commitments, and your training commitments. It will give proper weight to your training and will ensure that any clashes are managed in advance. This is a significant step towards co-rostering, ending the situation under the current contract where rotas can be imposed at little notice or consultation, as we saw during the pandemic. We've also strengthened the role of co-production of rosters throughout the new TCS, with reference to allowing time to trainees for rostering duties. There will now also be contractual timescales for how far in advance the work schedule, duty roster, and slot are provided to you. Employers must also now provide a system to allow trainees to apply for annual leave prior to the placement starting. Here you can see the contractual deadlines by which employers would have to provide each element of the work schedule. As you will know, there is no requirement in the current contract for rotas to be provided in advance. This key change will ensure that you will now know a reasonable time in advance what to expect from a replacement, so that you can plan your life, your leave, your holidays, and your childcare in advance. For LTFT trainees, work schedules must now be bespoke, and work should begin on agreeing them as soon as possible following confirmation of the placement. Clinical academics, where they are employed by the NHS and working under this contract, their academic commitments should also be reflected in the work schedule. For GP trainees, their work schedules must reflect the 40-hour sessional split in COG-PED guidance, with any additional hours above 40 only permissible if linked to the curriculum.
Hi, I'm Milan Makwana, Deputy Chair of the Welsh Junior Doctors Committee. Next, we're going to talk about exception reporting. So exception reporting is a significant change, a new system for reporting when the hours you actually work or the type of work you have done varies from what is agreed on your work schedule. We heard over and over again from trainees that the rota monitoring system in Wales was simply no longer fit for purpose. Banding appeals rarely saw sufficient participation to be valid, and rotas were designed to work you to an absolute maximum within the banding you were on. It was clear this system needed changing to one that was more individualised, was ongoing, not just episodic like rota monitoring, and was more convenient and transparent. Although we know the implementation of exception reporting in England has been mixed depending upon location, through the engagement work we did in the first phase of the contract talks, we believe we and employers have learned those lessons and stand ready to implement a better version of this system in Wales with some key negotiated improvements. So what is exception reporting? Exception reports are digital reports sent to an individual, relevant individual, that detail an event where the actual working pattern that took place or the hours worked varied from the work schedule. This could be due to a range of factors: missed training, lack of cover, missing a break, or working over your agreed hours due to too much demand on the wards. Exception reports would allow trainees to be appropriately compensated for their actual hours of work and ensures that safe working limits described earlier are kept to. If you are conscientious with your exception reporting, you can ensure you are properly paid for all the work you do. Exception reports also enable employers to see working hour transgressions from a bigger picture view, see the pinch points and problem areas, and take steps to address these to improve working conditions. It's fair to say that implementation of exception reporting in England has been mixed, with some trust implementing it much better than others. Part of that is cultural, which is an important area we have considered, but it stems from the system that is in place. That's why we negotiated a single national model for exception reporting, which will be rolled out consistently in Wales. This will be a digital solution integrated as closely as possible with the rostering system that will be designed specifically in time for implementation. Reporting will happen via a simple form which will simply ask you to enter the type of exception, when and where it happened, what was already been done, and if any other doctors were affected. This last part is an important change we fought hard to negotiate. We know that one of the problems in England is the culture, with trainees worried that exception reporting will make them look like they're causing a problem. Often this is because they'll be in a team where multiple people had the same problem, missing training or working over, but nobody quite wants to be the first person to report it. By allowing an exception report to flag where multiple people are affected, and the actioner then having to investigate this and file multiple reports if appropriate, it will ensure exception reporting becomes a more routine affair where everyone is involved and nobody singled out. Ultimately, the culture that we want to encourage, and employers agree on this, is one where all problems, no matter the size or how they're solved, are noted on the system and it becomes a routine part of work and professional duty. Exception reports will all have a clear actioner. Often this will be immediate manager at the time of the incident, but your educational supervisor will always be copied in too. The appropriate course of action will depend upon the issue. By default, overtime reports should be granted time off in lieu, although you will be paid if this can't be taken promptly, an additional payment or changes to the work schedule even. As just mentioned, where other trainees are affected, the actioner will investigate and ask them to file further reports if needed. Some breaches of safe practice, safe working limits are sufficiently serious that if reported, they will incur a financial penalty upon your employer. These are the safe working limits outlined earlier. If this occurs and you report it, then the guardian of safe working will fine the department. Some of this money will go towards you for the additional hours at higher penalty rates, and some will go towards areas of trainee benefit within the hospital. There are similar fines for missed breaks, and the guardian will also be able to levy multiple fines if multiple doctors have been affected. Where frequent exception reporting or serious breaches of safe working hours are occurring, you, your supervisor, or the guardian may request a work schedule review. This will take the form of a conversation between you and your educational supervisor to discuss the issue and what can be adjusted in your work schedule to improve it. It may be that no change is required, that prospective changes are made to the work schedule, that compensation or time off is agreed, or that wider organisational changes are taken forward. There are two stages of review if you're unhappy with the outcome of the review. You can read more about these in the framework agreement. Underpinning exception reporting is the Guardian of Safe Working. This is a new senior appointment that all health boards will be obliged to create that will oversee the maintenance of safe working hours and have access to exception reporting systems on an organisation-wide basis. Where action is not taken at a departmental level, they will be empowered to intervene and solve issues. They will also have reporting duties to the organisational board to highlight where issues are occurring. Conscious of the single lead employer in Wales, we have agreed with employers that will be a lead guardian hosted by the lead employer to manage their role and responsibilities regarding safe working practices. There will also be a dedicated GP guardian to manage the specific issues GP trainees face in practice settings regarding exceptional reporting.
My name is Merlin Gable. I'm the Senior Policy Advisor at BMA Cymru Wales. I'll be talking about other changes to terms and conditions and also transitional arrangements. So before summing up, I'll speak briefly about these two issues and then pass on to Evan. Another role that will be introduced is the Champion of Flexible Training. The Champion is a strategic role to promote and improve support for less than full-time and other models of flexible training. The role recognises the fact that more and more trainees are choosing to train flexibly and aims to support trainees and employers in implementing flexible training patterns through guidance and acting as a point of contact in all health boards. There are a few changes regarding locum work and fee-paying services. However, we don't have any concerns that these will particularly affect trainees. Trainees will be strongly encouraged, although not obliged, like in England, to offer their additional capacity first via an NHS bank before going to a locum agency. Trainees will also have a professional duty to ensure that their additional work does not exceed contractual safe working limits. For fee-paying services, the rule of minimal disruption will be introduced in line with the SAS and consultant contracts. If performing fee-paying services in working hours causes more than minimal disruption to NHS duties, it's about 30 minutes or less, the fee must be remitted to the employer or the time worked back. However, it's the committee's view that, even where there is more than minimal disruption taking place, it's relatively unlikely that this will be strongly enforced given the administrative burden of doing so. We managed to negotiate the contractualisation of significant elements of the NHS Wales Fatigue and Facilities Charter. Employers will now have specific responsibilities to provide facilities in line with the charter, as well as the standards for accommodation and support facilities. Host employers will have to provide food options where restaurant facilities are not open, as well as safe and accessible parking for those working after dark. Finally, on to transitional arrangements. Although there are no plans for a long phased approach to contract reform, and there will be no multi-year pay deal, there will be some transitional measures to ensure the smooth running of the health service during this time of change and to guarantee trainee salaries for those transferring. The implementation process has been defined by the Minister for Health and Social Services in the mandate she provided to us and employers for negotiation. In this, it stipulated that implementation should happen over 1 year between August 2023 and August 2024. There will be no multi-year pay deal. In our submission to the Minister, we made it clear that this would be both politically unwise and also difficult to manage given the economic climate. Thankfully, she agreed with our view, and instead this contract will be subject to the annual pay award next summer prior to its implementation alongside other branches of practice. This means the pay values you're seeing today are not final and aren't exactly what will be paid. In all likelihood, this will be higher due to the pay award. There will also be pay awards in future years thereafter also applying to the contract. This is critically important to us. We know that demands for pay restoration are high amongst junior doctors, and the BMA is committed as a union to work towards this across the UK. The Welsh Junior Doctors Committee is adamant that historic pay erosion must be addressed. However, it is also clear that this contract reform process is a unique opportunity to take forward changes that will benefit junior doctors with safer rotas, better protections, and more workplace rights. If this contract is approved, both of these things will be possible. BMA can continue our Wales-wide strategy towards pay increases, and if pay restoration is achieved for junior docs in England, then we can also lobby for the same here, as well as taking forwards our own Wales-focused campaigning. Trainee groups will be onboarded to the contract in a phased approach over the course of the year. This will be defined more precisely by an implementation programme board who will manage the implementation planning and later oversee its progress. There will be a wider review of operation of the contract in August 2026, examining the expenditure on the contract and whether this is in line with predictions, and also a review of pay protection arrangements in 2029. The first preference we have established for rotas is that trainees should only transfer over to the new contract when the relevant rotas have been made compliant with the new rules. We argued it was best to have this right from day one, rather than let there be complex sets of rules and different expectations for different trainees. This may mean that cohorts with more challenging rotas that require more changes may transition later in the year. However, we feel that the 9-month period between the end of the referendum and the August implementation start should be more than enough time to get a great deal of this work completed. However, where this hasn't been possible, we will agree transitional arrangements, which will be clearly defined and have clear end dates in a proportionate manner. This is not an area where we will be lax, and we would scrutinise any need for transition arrangements carefully before agreeing to them. Many of you will be wondering what happens to your pay. There will be some rotas that are paid more under the new contract, some considerably more, but also some that are paid less. This is an effect of the way the new contract values working hours in a fundamentally different way to the old contract and would always be the case with contract reform. However, we have negotiated pay protection for existing trainees who move over to the new contract. For these trainees, cash floor pay protection will be applied. This means that the pay you received the day prior to your transfer over to the new contract will act as an absolute floor in your earnings. So long as you remain in training, your pay won't drop below this. The value used will be your basic pay plus your banding supplement. This pay protection has been funded using some of the investment that Welsh Government provided for contract reform. However, it will not always be needed. As trainees progress up the pay scale and earn more than their cash floor, the sum used will drop. Therefore, we have agreed at the 2 and 5 year review periods that pay protection will be examined with government and employers. Any funding freed up by the tapering off of pay protection will be recycled and reinvested in junior doctor pay through a social partnership process determined at that time. This ensures that the investment Welsh Government have given us is used to its absolute maximum effect. This doesn't mean, however, that there will be a cliff edge after which pay protection will end. The reviews will be pragmatic and focus on usage of the protection at that time. We will take the position that pay protection should stay for as long as people need it.
Thank you very much for staying with us so far. This presentation has included a great deal of information. We will now briefly summarise the package again for you all, as well as providing some additional commentary before opening up to questions. So, in summary, this is a contract reform package which fundamentally reshapes the terms and conditions under which junior doctors would work. It is underpinned by a 3% additional investment by Welsh Government. This is recurrent, permanent funding that could not otherwise have been achieved. The pay system would be a 5-point nodal system linked to training grade, and we have ensured that this doesn't reflect historical pay erosion, so it is 4.8% higher than England's pay scale. Pay is for your hours of work done. There are pay rates for extra hours and hours in premium time. There are pay premium to recognise certain forms of training the NHS wants to encourage, as well as specific experience certain trainees bring to the health service. There are comprehensive working hours protection that end the most fatiguing working patterns and ensure trainee and patient safety. There are personalised work schedules to better balance training and clinical work. Exception reports would be introduced to manage overtime reporting and missed training, amongst other things. The Guardian of Safe Working will oversee safe working hours and ensure the exception reporting system works smoothly. Champions of Flexible Training will act as advocates for less than full-time trainees. WJDC think there are a host of advantages to this deal that makes it a significant improvement upon the current contract. When we consulted members prior to negotiation, it was clear that trainees were fatigued, overworked, felt undervalued and lacking in personal and professional recognition. We think that these areas have all been addressed in the proposed reforms. First of all, the significant increase in basic pay across grades represents a significant increase in pensionable pay, which will enhance NHS pensions contributions. This basic pay will be 4.8% higher than England's, which means we don't carry across the pay erosion experienced there over the last 4 years. Pay for hours work. Replacing the banding system means that trainees are fairly paid for their work and its specific intensity and inconvenience. The additional investment of 3% of workforce costs by Welsh Government is permanent funding provided for contract reform only, which we could not otherwise could have obtained. By not having a multi-year pay deal, we are able to continue to campaign on pay erosion alongside the rest of the association. We will not be stuck to a deal that does not serve members, and instead will continue to be free to lobby for higher pay and better recognition directly to the government and through the review body process each year. The flexible training pay premium will continue to recognise the experience of trainees who take time out after foundation and offer some additional pay to those who change specialty. One of the most important things the committee believes is a significant and robust working hours limits. These promise to really change the experience of working and training in Wales and improve work-life balance by ending fatiguing and antisocial working patterns. Exception reporting and work scheduling will both personalise and professionalise role time management and reporting of overtime, as well as missed opportunities in training. Trainees will now have proper plans for their work, similar to job plans for consultants. that allow them to take responsibility for and manage the balance of their training needs and clinic commitments. Exception reporting ends the constant frustration of banning appeals failing due to insufficient monitoring numbers, and allows trainees to finally insist upon the pay due to them for the work that they do. Deadlines for provisions of rotas and work schedules will be contractualized, helping you plan for new placements and apply for leave well in advance. Fixed leave will be banned, and the definition of a day of annual leave will be contractually defined as a shift of any length that doesn't attract an hourly enhanced rate. There are a whole host of new employer responsibilities, including for adequate facilities in line with the fatigues and facilities charter. As with any contract reform process, there have to be trade-offs. Whilst we think the committee have done a good job achieving important wins and improvements for trainees, naturally, we couldn't get everything we wanted, and there were some trade-offs with employers. First amongst this is a loss of automatic pay progression and an incremental pay scale based upon years in service. We were clear to the employers of the risks posed by ending this pay progression system, both in terms of trainee feelings but also fairness, given the complex and highly varied ways in which trainees choose to move through their training. Nevertheless, this was an absolute red line for employers and Welsh Government on the basis of for reform. Unfortunately, we had to reach the conclusion that there would be no contract reform and none of the benefits we've just described without this change. We've seen the same across the public sector and across other medical contracts. We have worked hard to mitigate the worst effects of this through the flexible training pay premium and the guarantees around pay progression during parental leave. Second, there is the extension to plain time from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. Again, this was an absolute red line in an area where employers demanded alignment with England. Although weekend daytime only attracts a normal hourly rate, the weekend frequency allowance does compensate for the additional inconvenience of weekend working, albeit in a very different way. And we believe the inclusion of Friday evenings for the purposes of this calculations for full shift rotas is a significant improvement. Finally, the pay system fundamentally reconfigures the landscape. There will always be winners and losers. We hope we have ensured that there are more winners than there are losers. In any event, current earnings for current trainees will be pay protected using the cash flow calculation, inclusive of banding. However, future earnings may change compared to if the current contract were maintained. I recommend that you examine our sample pay journeys closely found on the website, as well as use the Ready Reckoner for pay to better understand the pay system for yourself. Finally, I will convey to you the view of the Welsh Junior Doctors Committee on the contract deal. They considered the deal in detail once the negotiation team reported back to them and concluded that it achieved the core aims they had set out and offered significant improvements. Therefore, they decided by a significant majority to endorse this contract deal and are urging all members to vote to accept the contract deal. Their rationale is as follows. We have been clear, as have Welsh Government, that contract reform is a process to examine how to improve and refine working conditions, working systems, and the way in which different types of work is valued through pay. The question of overall pay levels, in other words, whether overall junior doctors are paid what they are worth, is a different one, and that contract reform does not set out to address. Instead, this process is determined through the pay review body and through the BMA's wider direct lobbying on pay. The proposed contract will end dangerous and unhealthy working patterns whose demise are long overdue. This was a key demand of members and will be transformational for many. Safety must always be at the heart of reform, and the protections of the contract are comprehensive and robust. They should not be considered lightly and were hard-won from employers. The significant uplift English pay scales is a huge positive for trainees in Wales and demonstrates that we can take a different approach here. There's no multi-year pay deal, which ensures that we can be reactive to what happens over the next few years regarding the economy and continue to campaign for full pay restoration. If the deal is accepted, there will be a new start for trainees in Wales after 20 years of the current contract. Clearly, there will be always be room for improvement, and the contract will be a living document we can continue to negotiate on after it is implemented. WJDC is clear that pay erosion must be addressed as a priority. This was not the process by which to do that. However, we can have the new contract and continue to campaign for pay restoration. However, if the contract is rejected, all of the improvements contained within it would not happen. Welsh Government is highly unlikely to negotiate any changes to the old contract, which has remained unchanged for 15 years, and the unsafe working hours and the unworkable rota monitoring system will remain. With all this, trainees in Wales will still be no closer to pay restoration. For all these reasons, the committee recommends voting in favour of the new contract. So, what happens from here? First, we recommend that you carefully review all the documents we've produced. These are the framework agreement. This is a full comprehensive overview of the deal we have agreed with government and employers. Next, the comparison with the old contract document. You can use this to understand the key changes and see the two contracts side by side. The sample pay journeys. This show examples of imaginary trainees who win from the contract and some who lose. It also shows how this happens and why on a year-by-year basis. Next, the pay ready reckoner. This is a lookup table that allows you to calculate pay levels on a new contract based upon the number of additional and enhanced hours being worked. After this, if you have any questions, you can either ask them now or write to welshjdcontract@bma.org.uk, where staff and experts will be able to advise you. Please note, we are not able to provide individual advice on how your pay may change. If you're not already a member, you must join in order to vote on the deal. Please ensure you join the BMA by 14th of October to ensure you receive a vote. The referendum will open on 3rd of October. You'll be emailed by a company called Civica, who manages the referendum on our behalf. However, we will also email you closer to the time to remind you if you are a member. The referendum will close on 21st of October. After this point, we will announce the results. Many thanks for your time and patience. We now proceed to a question and answer session. Why was it agreed for Saturday and Sunday to be playing time between 7 a.m. and 9 p.m. I think for this first question, if I can invite Dr. Stephanie Rees to answer this.
Yeah, so changes to working hours that are paid at a normally hourly rate was obviously a really difficult area of negotiation, and it wasn't something that we accepted lightly. However, it's incorrect to say that Saturday and Sunday are squarely in playing time. They are more expensive to roster you for, but they do this in a different way through the weekend frequency allowance. In addition to this, the hourly rate, like in the week, is paid either an enhanced or a standard rate, depending on the time of day. It was unfortunately a red line of employers that playing time should extend to 9 p.m. in the evenings. This means that they would not agree to a contract that did not contain this. In other words, the negotiations would have failed. Therefore, the negotiation team made the decision to gain maximum value from accepting this. This is how we were able to ensure that shifts beginning on a Friday evening and extending to a Saturday morning would be included into the weekend frequency allowance calculations, which is an improvement on the English agreement. To be clear, we do believe that there can be we do believe that there can be a new contract that with We do believe that there can't be a new contract that would not include this change.
Thank you, Dr. Rees. We'll move on to our next question then. Again, a very good question. With the extension of the normal hourly rate to 9 p.m. And then probably the person submitted this question indicated that that is an extreme example. Could doctors working 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday have their roles changed to 1 p.m. to 9 p.m. at no extra cost to trust? If I could invite one of our policy advisors, Merlin Gable, to answer this question.
Sure, thank you, Evan. So the change to enhanced working hours from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. in the evening will make it slightly cheaper to roster evening work, although direct comparison is very difficult because no element of the overtime is directly attributable to pay under the current banding system, because the definition of each band is so broad. You can't just say, well, this specific hour of work contributes to my banding. It's broader than that. The change here doesn't mean that rotas will automatically change. Indeed, overall, we expect intense antisocial working patterns to decrease as a result of the comprehensive rota safeguards contained in the new contract. Where there will be changes, these will be within safe working limits. And furthermore, I think it's important to recognise that the clinical demand will be needed to justify changes to working hours. In many specialties, this won't be present, and it's always more expensive to roster an underutilised staff member than to roster no one at all. So where demand is present, so for instance, in this example, conceivably, I guess, maybe in an A&E department, it may be that over time, employers will reconfigure rotas taking advantage of some of these changes. However, as before, this will be in line with safe rostering, and we'll also have to take into account the contracted hours of other medical and health professionals to assemble a team, obviously. The extreme example given here is an unlikely one to come about in part because you would expect 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. arguably to be of higher demand than 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. in terms of clinical work. Ultimately, employers made clear, as Steph just said, that any reduction in the enhanced hours in this way was a red line for them. And even so, we were able to make the change that Steph just mentioned regarding weekend working in the Friday night in exchange for doing this. Hopefully that's a useful explanation.
Thank you, Merlin. Moving on to our next question. Also a very good question, nice and short one. Will this new contract only apply to doctors in training, or will it apply to locally employed junior doctors as well? Could I invite Dr. Milan Makwana to answer this question?
Thank you, Evan. Yeah, I think the contract reform is to the terms and conditions of service for doctors and dentists in training. So it will not automatically cover locally employed doctors. However, I think where these doctors are working under the same rotas, employers have told us that they would not want to run hybrid rotas, really, with different people on substantially different contracts. I think, therefore, with regards to the rota and safeguards, we would expect these to be carried across to local contracts. With regards to pay on local contracts, these currently mirror the current training contract. In time, I guess, we would expect them to also mirror the new contract if it is introduced with similar wider terms too. So I think, yeah.
Thank you, Milan. Moving on to our next question. Again, a very good question. Do you have any illustrative pay journeys for someone on an NROC rota? Could I invite Dr. Stephanie Rees again to answer this question?
Yeah. So unfortunately, there was quite a short period of time between concluding negotiations and us wanting to get this out to you, so you had the most amount of time available to think about it before the vote, and that made it impossible for us to make pay journeys that covered every possible group of trainees. We've tried to make them cover as many as we can. NROC, because of the difficulty around how it's currently paid, is very different from the new banding system, and as was described earlier, it's very difficult to make rotas compliant for both contracts. We couldn't get that done in time, unfortunately. But if you want to work this out for yourselves, there should be enough information on the BMA contracts page for you to be able to get a general idea on predicted pay and work scheduling for NROC. And if you have any further questions, please contact Welsh JDC contract at bma.org.uk and they should be able to help you.
Thank you, Dr. Rees. The email address is on our main webpage if you wanted to email us. Moving on to our next question. How will the cash flow protection work if you are 60% less than full time in 2022-2023 and then become 80% in years 2023-2024? Will you be pay protected? Are you pay protected up to what you have earned on the old contract at 80% or based on the 60%? So quite a very specific question here. If I can invite Merlin to come in.
Sure, no problem, Evan. So your cash flow pay protection will scale with your percentage of less than full time for changes in the future. So it's based, as we said in the presentation, on your salary, your basic salary plus your banding on the day prior to transition. However, if your LTFT percentage were to scale up in the future, if you take on more work and a higher training percentage, then it will scale proportionately with that. And equally, if you were to go from full time to less than full time after the transfer date, your pay protection would scale as well, proportionate the amount of whole time equivalent work that you were doing. So hopefully that helps with that question.
Thank you, Merlin. Moving on to our next question. Very good question about pensions. Is it a positive or negative to increase the contributions for NHS pensions, given loads of senior doctors are trying to reduce their contributions? So quite a really real life kind of scenario going on with senior doctors and their pensions. If I can invite Dr. Milan McWana to come in with an answer for this, if that's all right.
Thanks, Evan. Yeah, I think this is quite topical at the moment, isn't it? And I think we do recognise the concerns regarding the sort of pension lifetime allowance, which have caused significant tax implications for some doctors later in their careers. And we're seeing that in the media at the moment. I think whilst it is true that higher pension contributions earlier in your career may contribute earlier to the lifetime allowance, I think we are clear that the lifetime allowance must change sooner rather than later. And I think we see it as an unlikely that the lifetime allowance will be, a significant factor over the course of the coming decades with regards to pension planning for most junior doctors. It remains the case that higher pension contributions, I think earlier in your career, will maximise the value of a pension later in life.
Thanks, Bill. So moving on to our next question, and quite really, we've covered a lot of, broad themes, and it's an excellent question being submitted here. Next one is something that will be in the contract, and should reporting be workload and extra workload based on HR. If I can invite Stephanie Reeves to come in here.
Can I just double check? Can I get a nod if no one else heard Merlin there, or is it my computer? Evan. Okay, so I'll repeat the question. Will exception reporting be workable given the extra workload it will place on HR? So exception reporting will be as automated and as integrated as possible. Hopefully there'll be as little manual intervention as possible beyond the actioner to ensure that you are paid for the overtime that you work, if that's the agreed outcome. However, there will be some impacts upon HR resources by the introduction of the new contract. These will be considered carefully during the implementation planning period and plans put into place to manage both the transitioning and ongoing administrative demands on the new contract. The Guardian of Safe Working will be a fully financed, properly resourced role with dedicated funding as part of the contract reform. And this will hopefully ensure that the guardians will have the time and support that they need to fulfil their duties, overseeing the exception reporting system, monitoring safe working hours, and levying fines on employers where necessary.
Thank you, Stephanie. Apologies, you kind of have a webinar without a bit of technical issues, but hopefully that's okay right now. Next question, how much are the fines that health boards will be issued for breaches to safe working limits? Very good question. Can I have Merlin to come in for this?
Sure, no problem. The exact value of these fines is going to be defined in the first PACE circular that would be associated with this contract, which would be issued presumably next summer. And it will be updated in line with the pay awards each year. But the principle of the fines, if this is helpful, is that it shouldn't be cheaper for an employer to work a trainee beyond their safe working limits than it would have been for them to otherwise employ a locum for that shift. So the rates, therefore, are defined as twice the relevant locum rate for the hours affected. A proportion of this is paid out to the trainee as compensation, and then the rest will contribute to a fund which will be used for the benefit of trainees as determined both by trainees through a junior doctor forum and by the guardian of safe working as well, so dedicated to improvements for junior docs on that site.
Thank you, Merlin. And I can see we're still very good for time, so we'll keep going. Next question, who will be better off and who will be worse off as a result of this contract? Really good question. We've covered this somewhat in talks, but I think it's useful to hear this in an extended version. Can I have Dr. Milan Makwana come in to answer this question?
Thanks, Evan. Yeah, happy to answer that. I think the new contract fundamentally values pay differently to the old contract. So for basic pay, the nodal point pay system replaces the current incremental pay scale. I think instead of that, the sort of broad brush approach of the banding supplement, additional pay in this contract is instead split into additional hours, up to 48, which is a good safe limit, a 37% premium for work performed between 9 p.m. and 7 a.m. and a weekend frequency allowance, I guess dependent on the number of weekends that you work. I think because of this, it is difficult to make direct comparisons between the two contracts and pinpoint who exactly will be better off and worse off. However, I think it is possible to make some general observations. We know that registrars who have accrued a significant number of years of service may benefit less from the contract or see lower future pay if they're not at a similar high level of training. I think that's because the end of automatic pay progression based upon years in service, which allows trainees to accrue, I guess, high levels of basic pay in this way without necessarily equivalent progression in their training. So, I mean, this may affect trainees who retrain in a second specialty or who, I guess, plan to take significant periods out of training. I think in some important instances, for example, retraining and taking F3 years, we have negotiated the flexible training pay premium to mitigate some of the loss of that pay. The new contract redistributes the money unevenly distributed due to the automatic pay progression system in order to spread it, I guess, more evenly across the greater majority of trainees. Therefore, I think many average trainees may expect to see somewhat higher pay under this proposed contract. Now, our calculations show that many trainees on typical training pathways, GP, general medicine, general surgery, may all overall benefit sometimes significantly in terms of pay over the course of a training career. However, we should stress actually again that for current trainees who may see a direct reduction in their pay as a consequence of transfer, they will be pay protected, meaning their basic pay plus their banding supplement will be counted as a cash floor below which their future pay will not be able to drop. And I think that's an important point to make there. I think in significant ways, all trainees will benefit from the new contract by safer working hours, introduction of exception reporting, the end of fixed leave, and better facilities and other improvements that the contract will bring with it.
Thank you, Milan, for that very comprehensive answer. Moving on to our next question, working on a very different team, which is great. How reliable are guarantees regarding rest facilities and the guardian of safe working when we haven't seen this work in England? Good question. Can I have Stephanie to come in to answer this?
Yeah. So the contractualisation of rest facilities is a new element of the Welsh contract. In the English one, it only mentions that employers should consider providing these facilities. In the Welsh one, they must. So we're confident this will lead to better facilities provision in Wales. The Guardian of Safe Working role has, it's true, been more successful in some trusts in England than others. Often this is because it's inadequately resourced. In Wales, Welsh Government provided dedicated funding to these roles to ensure that they will have the correct number of sessions based upon the number of trainees in their health board to undertake the role successfully. And we think this will lead to a much better oversight of safer working hours than we've seen in some parts of England.
Thank you, Stephanie. Moving on to our next question. So what if the referendum votes no? Will you return to negotiations? Interesting question. If we can, Merlin, to come in to answer this.
Sure, no problem. I think, you know, obviously as a member of staff, I would say it's ultimately the view of the Welsh Junior Doctors Committee as to what the next step would be in this situation. But I think I can give a kind of realistic idea of what the kind of lay of the land is here. If the referendum returns a no vote, it's our view realistically that the package may well be withdrawn, the one that's on offer at the moment, as well as the additional 3% funding that we secured, and trainees would remain as they are on the 2002 contract. If the government were willing to consider a return to negotiation, which isn't guaranteed, we would seek to understand what caused members to vote no, and clearly would look to return to negotiation on that basis, if possible. However, we should make clear the limits within which further negotiation could take place and make realistic expectations around that. Certainly, there's no option to simply improve the current contract. We explored the whole area of contract reform for a number of years with government and employers during this process. It became clear the only avenue for contract reform is along the lines we're presenting today. In particular, Welsh government and employers will not accept a contract, we believe, that does not end automatic pay progression based upon years in service and that does not extend normal working hours slightly in the evening to 9 p.m. It was very clear that these were government's red lines, partly because alignment with the contract in England is very important to them. So all the changes that we managed to negotiate above and beyond the English contract were very much hard won by the negotiating team. Therefore, it may be that even after further negotiation, the choice before you all would be very similar to the one that you're faced with today, the proposed contract that we've just presented. We think we've negotiated as many improvements as we can. And it may be that if this isn't an option, then it would be to remain on the old contract in perpetuity.
Thank you, Merlin, for the answer. Moving on to our next question. So who negotiated this contract? Are they junior doctors? If I can have Milan to answer this question.
Thanks, Evan. Yeah, the negotiating team were competitively recruited from the Welsh Junior Doctors Committee from 2019 through to 2021. So it was very much composed of a member of BMA staff, five junior doctors working in Wales. All of them had received training on the BMA's negotiating strategy, which has been developed in conjunction with industry experts. So this method was introduced after talks in England and broke down back in 2016. Now, I guess before any negotiating took place, we engaged quite extensively with junior doctors in Wales in events across the country through an All Wales survey. Now, what this did give us is quite a lot of detailed qualitative and quantitative information on the problems junior doctors faced and what solutions they wanted to see. This formed very much the basis of the priorities we took forward into negotiation. I think the negotiating positions that the team took were approved at every stage by the WJDC and a reference group that included representation from across the BMA, including from the Welsh committees and areas of specific expertise, for example, less than full-time training and GP training, as well as from the British Dental Association. So it was very much a comprehensive effort.
Thank you, Milan. With you pretty all right for time, we've got 15 more minutes, so we keep going with questions. Will the cash flow protection be based on rotation salary or annual salary? If I can have Stephanie to come in to answer this.
So trainees moving from the old contract onto the proposed new contract as part of implementation will see their pay protected by a cash floor or a sort of no detriment arrangement based upon an annualised salary based on their current rotation, including banding, the day prior to their transfer to the new contract. Pay protection arrangements will be subject to review at 2 years and 5 years following completion of implementation to assess how many trainees are utilising their cash floor and consider the reinvestment of funding that gets freed up as trainees progress on through their training and no longer require that floor.
Thank you, Stephanie. Moving on to our next question. What's the point of the pay journeys when our rotas will change drastically anyway? Doesn't that make them a bit pointless? And how could you know what our rotas and pay will look like? Can I have Merlin to answer this, if that's okay?
No problem. So I think in the first instance, how will we know what pay will look like? It's actually very easy to work out pay on the new contract. You need only a few small pieces of information. How many hours are being worked total? How many of those hours are in unsociable hours, 9 p.m. to 7 a.m. What's the weekend frequency? Is there any NROC work contained? From there, you can work it out very simply. And what we did was the pay journeys we used were real rotas that have already been adjusted to make sure they're compliant with the new rota safeguards. So these are real rotas that could and likely would be implemented. This was done by health boards as part of the negotiation, using the same methods that they'll use to make the changes upon implementation to ensure compliance in the future. So certainly in the first instance, the piece of work that health boards and employers can be doing is making sure that all the rotas are compliant with the rota safeguards. I don't think they're particularly ambitious at the moment for any changes beyond that, to be honest. Therefore, they're representative of the rotas that we think would be worked under the new contract and therefore do represent pretty accurate costings, we reckon, to compare old and new contract and going forward in the future.
Thank you, Merlin. Next question. Interesting question as well. Have you considered the impact this plain time changes will have on locum rates? Milan, do you want to take this one?
Thanks, Evan. So I think locum work is extra contractual and its rates, I think, are set very much outside of the contract. I think locum rates can be negotiated between the employee and the employer, although the employer will sometimes have standard rates for day and night work. And I think this is only an offer and it can form the basis for individual negotiation. I guess, in effect, if you do not wish to do the work offered for the rate advertised, you are free to name your price, regardless of the time of day the work is being done. So, yeah.
Thanks, very succinct answer. Thank you for that. Next question. For out of training experience, it was briefly mentioned that it would count for something. But what about IMGs who had previous experience before training? Is that considered the same? If I can, Stephanie, answer this.
Yeah, so the flexible training pay premium will recognise experience gained outside of training after foundation training and before starting core or specialty training. And the criteria for this is engagement in 1 or 2 years of appropriately graded medical work in either the Welsh NHS, another NHS, or the health system of another country, and to have completed 2 satisfactory appraisals or ARCPs or equivalent. Therefore, the experience that IMG doctors will bring will be recognised under the flexible training pay premium when they move into Wales.
Thank you, Stephanie. Next question. If a trainee picks up a number of locum shifts to the point where they work above new safer working hours, what will happen? If I can have Milan to come in to answer this.
Sure, yeah. I think all of us pick up different shifts, perhaps, and I think it's a professional duty of a trainee to not breach their safe working limits by really undertaking additional locum work. However, we do not believe this will be explicitly monitored by your employer, and it will really be up to you to self-police this. I think clearly, as a trade union, we cannot recommend that trainees are working beyond what are defined as safe working limits.
Thank you, Milan. Next question, regarding cash flow pay protection, my understanding of what you mentioned is that it is a one-off payment on transition, but you also said that it should continue as long as it's needed. Can you please clarify that? Merlin, do you want to take this one?
Sure, no problem. So apologies if it was slightly unclear in the presentation. It's not a one-off payment. It's calculated once. So the value of it is calculated the day prior to your transition onto the new contract, based upon the basic pay and spend banding at that time. But it forms an ongoing cash floor against which your salary on the new contract per rotation is compared. And if your salary on the new contract is lower than that cash floor, you'll be paid the cash floor instead. There's a review at year five of implementation of how many people are going to be using it, as was just mentioned, and how we can reinvest those funds as they're freed up, because that's part of the permanent funding that the Welsh Government provided for junior doctors here, and we want to make sure that it's used in a way that's permanent eventually. But for this time, we had to make sure that there was some form of pay protection for trainees who are already training in Wales and transition them over to this contract in a way that was fair and smooth. So that's why this is being used, but obviously the money will remain in place after that, and we want to reinvest it in junior doctor pay so that it remains part of the pay packet in Wales. It's going to be our view that really this pay protection should be in place as long as it's needed, and as long as people are using it, they should be able to receive it within reason. There's no plan in our view for a cliff edge at the fifth year where suddenly it's cancelled. I don't think that would be acceptable.
Thanks for that very clear clarification. Next question, how much are the fines that health boards will be issued for breaches to safe working limits? Staff, you want to take this one?
So the exact value of the fines will be defined in the pay circular that will be issued when the new contract is implemented, and they will be updated in line with pay awards. The principle of the fines, as said earlier, is that it shouldn't be cheaper for an employer to work a trainee beyond their safe working limits rather than employing someone else like a locum to have done that job instead. So currently the rates are therefore defined as twice the relevant locum rate for the hours affected, and a proportion of this fine is paid out to the trainee as compensation. The rest will contribute to a fund whose use will be for the benefit of trainees as determined by the Guardian of Safe Working and the Junior Doctors Forum.
Thank you, Steph. Moving on to the next question we have. A good one about annual leave. In terms of annual leave, are you then saying that an 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. shift, for example, could be taken as annual leave as it doesn't fall outside 7 to 9? Merlin, do you want to take this one?
Sure. This is absolutely correct. This is what we've negotiated. So as long as the shift takes place within normal working hours, paid at the normal hourly rate, not the enhanced hourly rate, then regardless of its length, it will be taken as one day of leave. This ends a situation that we saw in some health boards where some employers were insisting, for example, that a 10-hour shift should cost 1.25 days of annual leave rather than one day, because it's 25% higher than 8 hours, which is considered a normal working day. So that will no longer be the case. And as you say, an 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. shift, it's all within the 7 to 9. Therefore, you can take it as one day of annual leave.
Thank you, Wayne. I think that's clearly a big win, and I think a lot of juniors will be reassured to hear that. So this will be, we've got about two more questions left, being wary of time. If the aim is due full pay restoration, what would this due be endorsed by the BMA, given it's not in any way close to that. Can I have staff to answer this, if that's okay?
Yeah, so it's our view that pay restoration and contract reform are two different things and they're not mutually exclusive. This contract reform is about the conditions under which you work, your working hours, your reporting system, and how the pay scale works. The overall levels of pay is determined normally through the annual pay awards following the review body recommendations. And as many of you will know, the BMA is currently also engaged on a pay campaign, demanding that pay be restored to the same level as it was in 2008. Because this deal does not include a multi-year pay deal, which would commit us to set pay uplifts yearly, we will be able to continue to campaign alongside the rest of the association on getting junior doctors in Wales the proper pay rises that they deserve, all the while still benefiting from the improvements that this contract will bring to your working lives.
Thank you, Steph. Last question we have actually, we're going to take today due to time. So you referred a few times that there will be no multi-year pay in you. Can you please explain what that means? Kind of Milan to answer this, if that's okay.
Sure, thanks, Evan. I think there will be no multi-year pay deal as part of the contract reform. I think this removes the risk of agreeing now to uplift in the future. That may not be acceptable in light of unknown, I guess, inflation. This means that alongside the 3% investment that the Welsh Government this year in contract reform have provided, I think it provides a 4.8% uplift on the 2016 contract pay values, as in England this year. Junior doctors in Wales will still be eligible for a pay award next year via the normal pay review process, the DDRB, prior to the commencement of, I guess, implementation, as well as, I guess, in all other sort of future years. So, yeah.
Thank you, Milan. So that was our last question we were going to take with time, and I think we are going to end spot on, well, actually a minute before eight. Thank you. I just want to say thank you to everyone for joining on the work night. It's, you know, we know how much data you've been presented and how many numbers to go through. It's not a very easy kind of presentation to go through after work, but so we do thank you. And you know, this will be available on demand on our website, so you know, you feel free to go back to this to go through any points that or any slides that you wanted to recap. As Steph mentioned, we are always available to answer questions on the email as well that will be on our main webpage for the contract reform talks. And you know, just if you want to see us face to face in person, we are still on the road in the moment, so do go to your nearest event happening in your local hospital. I just want to highlight that please be a member. You get a vote only if you're a BMA member, so please remember to join the BMA, and please remember to vote. Ballot opens on Monday, so be ballot ready for that. And with that, I bid everyone a good evening. Thank you very much for joining us.